Why this case is not all over every single platform, why there's not 50 documentaries made about this, I just do not understand. Before we get into this video though, I do want to let you guys know that this video is for educational and entertainment purposes only. Please remember to be kind to everybody everywhere in your everyday life, in your home, in the grocery store, and especially in the comment section down below. Please do not show hate to anybody, anywhere. Good morning, my lovelies, my beauties, my friends. My name is Christina and welcome to my channel. If you're new here, thank you so much for clicking on this video. I really hope that you will subscribe, stick around, take a chance on hearing some things that I have to say. And if you are a returning subscriber, y'all already know, y'all are my babies. So good morning, good morning, good morning. How is everybody doing today? I hope you all are having an amazing day. You guys, this case right here, like how? You may have not heard of the Gregory Green case because I had never heard of it until one of you guys, one of my babies, sent it to me in a DM over on Instagram. And it's so crazy too, because sometimes I'll get tons of messages about a certain case. Sometimes I'll get, you know, one message and it just doesn't stick with me. I don't vibe with it. And then every now and then, like in this situation, somebody will send me one message. I've only seen one person send me something on this. And when I read about this case about it, I was like, whoa, why aren't more people talking about this? This is nuts, you guys. You guys are in for a very wild ride. If you guys don't already know me though, hi, my name is Christina. I do have a second channel, which is Casually Christina. We do things more casually over there. I also have a Patreon. My Patreon is for 18 and up. It's more personal story times and stuff like that over there. We go live. It's a good time if you would like to join. We also have a podcast as well as I have an Instagram, and all of those are always linked down in the description box if you would like to come and check me out. All right, so before we get into this, you guys, I do want to let you guys know that I will leave some links down in the description box. Go look for them if you guys want to watch like court stuff or whatever. So first I'm going to tell you guys the whole story, and then I'm going to give you guys my full opinions on certain things and things for you to think of at the end. And I also want you guys to hold the thought of this video because I have another video coming up soon. You guys will see. You'll see. So let's just get into the case of Gregory Green. Now, there's not a lot out there about Gregory Green's past. He was born in 1966. He come from what I can find, a good family, a mother that loved him, a father that loved him. I don't know too much about his siblings. I did read somewhere that he had a sister, that they all go to church. They're all very much involved in their church. And that's about it. I don't know whether he was bullied. I don't know if he struggled with any substances. I cannot find it, and we should be able to. This needs to blow up, okay? But neither here nor there. Now, when Gregory was in his upper 20s, he met his soon-to-be wife, LaTanya. She eventually did become LaTanya Green. She had two kids of her own, and then she became pregnant with his child in 1990. Now, we don't know a lot about this relationship either. Was it a great relationship? Was it a rocky relationship? We just don't know. But what we do know is that in 1991, in about July, LaTanya, or Tanya, told her best friend, she had a best friend since middle school, that she was going to leave him. Now, she was married to Gregory. She was like, I'm going to leave him. She's like, he's acting really weird. I think he's on some substances. I think he's taking some stuff. Like, he's doing all this weird stuff. He's getting kind of violent and irate. So what I'm going to do, she tells her best friend, what I'm going to do is I'm going to go to church Sunday morning. I'm going to pack a bag afterwards. And after church, I'm going to leave. Well, that day never came. At 1:30 a.m., Gregory Green calls 911. 911 dispatcher picks up and he says, hello. He says, I just killed my pregnant wife. I've stabbed her and she's dead. She's laying in the kitchen. Of course, the 911 dispatcher is probably asking all these questions. He goes and sits on the porch and he waits for the cops to come. When the cops come, they obviously put him under arrest. They go into the house and they find pregnant LaTanya's lifeless body laying on the kitchen floor. She had been stabbed in her face, her chest, stabbed all over the place, and she was gone along with her precious little baby that she was pregnant with. So he killed his first wife and his unborn child. Now, according to public records and reports, she had two children. Remember, one of the children were not there at the time, and the other one went and hid in the closet. So you could only imagine what this precious baby was hearing as he was killing her mother. And oh my gosh, you guys, it's just wild. So he gets arrested, obviously. He goes to court. He's charged with second-degree murder. Gregory starts telling, you know, his public defender or lawyer, whoever it is, that he's mentally ill. He wants to plead insanity. It doesn't end up, they do a mental evaluation on him, and he doesn't get the insanity plea. They end up sentencing him to 15 to 20 years. Yes, 15 to 20 years for killing your pregnant wife and your unborn baby. Now, Gregory's family stood behind him this whole entire time. Now, this is the problem with this case, is because we don't know exactly why he told them he did it, okay? We can't find out. Like, what did he tell his family? He had to have told his family something. Oh, I blacked out. I went nuts. I don't know what I was doing. Like, he had to have told them something. We don't know, but all we know is that he only got 15 to 20 years. And that happened. Starting in, I believe, 2004, Gregory started going up for parole. He was actually denied 4 times by the parole board. Each time they were saying that, like, he showed no remorse. He didn't understand what he had did wrong. I also read that for a long time, he was still blaming his wife for what happened. So, okay, so he's going before the parole board and he's like, well, she did this or she did that, and not like showing like he was like remorseful and like really sorry. They actually said he had a lack of empathy. Okay, he was turned down 4 times, not once, not twice. Not, the parole board was like, you are a danger to society, because that's what they do. They're trying to figure out if you are going to be an asset to society by being free, or if you are not going to be an asset. And so they turned him down 4 times. Well, at this point, Gregory Green's family is going hard for him, right? Like, his parents, his mom and dad, his pastor and his parents' pastor, like, his pastor had actually been coming to visit him and writing him the whole entire time that he was in there as well, okay? His sister who was in church. So everybody is having his back. They're seeing him get turned down for this parole and stuff. So they start writing letters, okay? In 2006, his mother wrote a letter to the parole board or to the judge, and this was part of the letter. She said, "We believe Gregory is very sorry for what he did and has gained insight into his behaviors." Listen, I know a mother's love, but he has gained insight. It took him this long. It's 2006, sister. Like, I know a mother's love, and I definitely don't want to disrespect anybody that's older than me, but this is my thoughts, okay? He gained insight. Okay, it's been 15 years, and he's gained some insight. Okay, hold on. "He has worked hard in prison and continues to make a positive adjustment." Then his sister told the parole board, "Over the years, Greg has become closer to the Lord and reads his word daily. I believe this is what has helped Greg through this difficult and trying time." So Fred Harris, who is actually the pastor that I was telling you guys about, he was not only a pastor, he was a civil rights activist. And as a pastor, he was like trying to, part of his mission and like his ministry was prison ministry. So he already knew Gregory, he knew the family, and he really had it tugging on his heart to help Gregory get out and, you know, just live a new life and be a testament of what God can do and change you and all of this stuff. So he really, really fought for Gregory to get out and have a second chance. He was a very, very popular pastor. He wrote many letters to the judge. Let me read you a part of a couple of them. "Gregory and I were friends before his mishap and he was incarcerated." Fred Harris, a pastor in Detroit, wrote to the Michigan Parole Board in August of 2005. "He was a member of our church. I feel he has paid for his unfortunate lack of self-control and the damage he has caused as much as possible, and is sorry. If he was to be released, he would be welcomed as part of our church community, and whatever we could do to help him adjust, we would." So everybody's going to bat for Gregory to get Gregory out, right? While Gregory was in prison, like, he was doing like all these like educational like courses that he could do and like mental health courses and stuff. And so in 2008, he went before the parole board again for the fifth time, okay? So now the parole board, there's 3 parole board members. They've gathered all the letters. They're sitting there in their chairs, like in front of this big table, One, two, three. They got all their letters. They got all their evidence. And here comes Gregory before them. They look in Gregory's past since he has been in prison, and they see that he actually hasn't been in any trouble. The staff, the correction officers, everybody from the prison says that he gets along with everybody. He's respectful. He had gotten into one fight in 2002, I believe it was, and gotten a write-up, and they were fighting over the television. Y'all know I've done told y'all all about that situation, the TV, the phones, it goes down, okay? But ever since then, he hadn't been in any trouble, and everybody really just spoke highly of him. The parole board, of course, wanted to know if they released Gregory, where he would go. Gregory's parents said he's going to be welcomed back into our home. He's already got a church community. He already had a job lined up for him. Really, the parole board had no reason to say no. So what they do is they vote. Two of them voted for yes. So that automatically overrules the third one. It's a vote like that. And in 2008, Gregory was released from prison after all of this. Yay, right? After all of his family, after the church standing behind him, after everybody, he made a mishap, according to the pastor, whatever that means, by killing his wife and his unborn child. And now he was going to get a second chance at life. Should be the end of the video right here, right? It's not. Gregory gets out and he's doing pretty good. Like, he's doing good. He's got him a job. He's been, you know, living with his mom and his family. He's getting along with everybody as far as we know. He's going to church. In 2010, he is released from parole, which means he completed whatever he had to do for his parole in only 2 years. Shocking to me, but nevertheless, that's exactly what happened. And he's released from parole. During this time, since he's been out, he was growing very, very close with the pastor's daughter. Oh, the good old pastor's daughter. Some of y'all are pastor's daughters out there right now, okay? He falls in love with the pastor's daughter. Faith Green is her name. She falls in love with him. Now, Faith Green has two teenage children at this point, a son and a daughter. Her teenage son's name was Chadney, and her teenage daughter's name was Kara. Kara or Kara. I'm sorry. I hope I'm getting it right. So they had been living with their mother. You know, they're going to church too. They get to know Gregory. And December 18th of 2010, Gregory and Faith become married. Now we have Faith Green, Gregory Green, living together in holy matrimony with Faith's two teenage children. Later down the road, Gregory and Faith end up having two children of their own, Coy and Kaylee. I always love that name, Coy. It's so beautiful. Kaylee is two, and so is all of the names are beautiful, but I just love Coy for some reason. And they're just living their best life together. So now it's all four of them, right? They're going to the church, like the pastor that fought to get him out. The pastor that was there for him, the pastor that wrote letters, the pastor that, you know, went and talked to Gregory's mom, the pastor that came and visited him in prison, the civil rights activist pastor, okay, whose mission and his heart was in prison ministry, that pastor. Gregory married his daughter, okay? The two teenagers are his grandchildren, and then now the two kids that they've had together, all four of those kids are this pastor, Pastor Harris's grandchildren. Eventually, Gregory started showing some rage at home. Now, there's not a whole lot on this. I wish there was, but I couldn't find a whole lot on this, okay? In 2013, just a few short years after Faith and Gregory were married, Faith went down and filed for a divorce. She wanted a breakdown of their marriage. She tried to get a protective order against him, actually. And she said that, like, he was, like, you know, being, like, rageful around the house, that he actually kicked the couch. They had their little baby at the time laying on the couch, and he kicked the couch with the baby on it, scared her. And that he was telling her that you better leave or you're going to regret it. He was trying to kick her out of their home, and her kids were there, right? And she's like, wait a minute, like, I'm not leaving. She said that this went on for hours, that he was walking around, you know, bowing up at her and, like, scaring the poo out of her. So she said the reason why she didn't call 911 right then or call the cops right then is because she had her kids there. She didn't want to go down and file a police report or a PPO at that time and leave her house because he was already threatening her. And so, you know, she said she waited until later. She went down and she tried to get a protective order. Now, I read part of the protective order. She was denied it. They did not give her a restraining order against him. Why she did not put on there that he had previously murdered his wife, I will never understand, but you know, hindsight is always 20/20. Now, this was in 2013. The paperwork for the divorce was dissolved because she never came back and did anything. She ended up going back to him, and that is something I want to talk to you guys about at the end here, okay? She went, she saw the signs in 2013 that he was getting a little wild. Whatever he did, he wooed her back in, all the promises, all the babies I want, all the, you know, whatever, maybe even a bit of that manipulation that makes you think that you were the problem the whole time, that you asked for it or you did it or whatever it was, she went back to him and they got back together. On August 11th of 2016, she went down, Faith did, down to the courthouse and she filed for a divorce again, okay? This was in August of 2016 at this point. On September 22nd of 2016, just 1 month after Faith filed for a divorce for the second time. Now, I'm assuming they're still living together at this point because just a few days before this date that I'm telling you guys about, they had a birthday party for one of their children that they had together, which was a 4-year-old little girl. As a matter of fact, there were still decorations outside and the neighbor said that they saw them going on picnics together. And the day before this date, the oldest boy, Chadney, was actually out in the front yard mowing the grass. So on this night, Gregory takes his wife, Faith Green, down to the basement and he zip ties her hands and her feet. While he is down there, he shoots her in the foot so she can't walk, she can't move or nothing. He takes a box cutter, he cuts her face from here to here and cuts her up in a bunch of other places. Then he takes their two youngest daughters. And he had already, and I've read different articles. I've read that at some point he went to like an Ace Hardware or a Home Depot or somewhere like that. And he got the materials to do this with. But he went to the car and he rigged the car up that way that the exhaust would filter back into the car or the carbon monoxide or whatever it is. And he put their two smallest children, the one baby that had just turned 4 years old and had that birthday, Coy and Kaylee, in the car with the exhaust running and poisoned them to death and killed them. After he put them in the car and did that, he took Faith's two oldest children, the ones that she had had from a previous relationship, down to the basement where she was tied up and slashed and shot. And he shot her two kids execution style in front of her 3 times and killed them while she laid there dying herself and screaming. And then he went upstairs and he called 911 and he said, "Hey, I just killed my family. Like, you need to come here." And he sat on the porch and waited for the cops to come again for the second time. When the cops came, they obviously rushed up. They put him in handcuffs and he didn't speak much. They said it was the most gruesome sight to go in and see what they found. They found the two babies dead in the car, and then they went down to the basement and they saw the two teenagers that had been killed and then the mother who actually lived. So they'd rush her off to the hospital and she's in intensive care and she stayed in there for a while. Now, you guys, this man killed his family twice. Not once, but twice. He went to court and it was so bizarre. He got up there when it was his turn. He went ahead and pled guilty. According to his public defender or his lawyer, he wanted to just get it over with. That pastor that fought for him to get out, the one that he married his daughter and then eventually killed his 4 grandkids, he did not speak at all. I have watched and searched and he has not released a statement at all. And I couldn't imagine. I could not imagine the guilt and the burden that man is carrying. Faith did show up to some of his court proceedings in a wheelchair at some point because she couldn't walk. She had been shot in the foot. She had this like hat on with this like black thing like hanging down. Like I could not imagine. And she did get up there and speak. And she said,
"I'm not happy. I'm not satisfied with the outcome. There's no punishment that fits the crime. Not even torture and death would be justice. Your justice will come when you burn in hell for all eternity for murdering 4 innocent children. all because you're insecure as a man. Plus the other two lives you took. You are a con artist, you are a monster, you are a devil in disguise. You are now forever exposed. But while I stand up here trembling with fear, I put on my bravest face to be in the same room with the man who murdered all four of my children. Two of them violently in front of me with a gun, Chadney and Kara. And he killed my other two babies, Coy and Kaylee, with a hose that ran from the tailpipe of his car to where they were innocently sleeping. As if that wasn't enough, let me tell you about some of the devastation that it has actually done to me and my family. My short-term memory is gone. Doctors tell me it's my brain protecting me from the memories of my children being shot in their heads right in front of me while I was gagged, duct-taped, and zip-tied. Every time I find strength to get out of bed, as soon as I walk, I'm in extreme pain, sharp pain, from where he shot me in my foot. They don't know if I'll ever walk again without pain. Think about that for a second, never being able to again to walk without pain. My doctors say I have post-traumatic stress disorder. That's where the migraines and nightmares come from. Sometimes I dream of the night all this happened and wake up screaming and sweating, thinking that I can save my children somehow. Then I realize that the nightmare is actually reality and my children are really gone, and I try to find the strength to start my day somehow. Other times, there's just crazy nightmares that I wake up from in fear and try to understand them, but I'm told that they all link back to this horrific experience I have had. I can't think of the last time I really rested without medication. I can still feel the zip ties around my wrist, and it triggers horrible memories of that night. There's times I find myself drifting off into thought and then realize I'm not thinking of anything. I'm empty, lost, really... I'm lost, not really knowing what to do with myself, just existing day to day. I miss my children so much that words will never be able to explain. All I ever wanted to be was a mother, a wife, have a happy family, raise my children to be productive members of society, and be happy. The reality I face now is this will never happen for me. Time will never heal this wound. I will always be empty. A part of me will always be missing. If the day ever comes when I do wake up and it's not the first thing that I think about, when I look in the mirror, I will always be reminded by the scars he put on my face, cutting me from my ears to my chin with a razor blade box cutter. The pain on the left side of my face never goes away. He cut me so deep that it severed multiple nerves that may never heal correctly. I lost so much blood. I was in critical condition for days. I should have died. Some days I wish I would have. He has scarred me for life. My whole family is devastated emotionally by what has happened, but it has extremely been hard on my parents. They love their grandchildren with all their hearts. Most days, my mother has a hard time getting out of bed and has been in the hospital a few times, but my father is taking it the hardest. He's not the same person he once was. The stress has taken a toll on his health. 2 weeks ago, he was taken to the hospital because he had a stroke. I honestly don't know where to go. From here, I'm numb. There's a hole in my heart and soul that can never be repaired. The loss to me is so big that I will never truly recover for the rest of my life. I will be forever in pain and heartbreak. This wound will never heal. This wound will never heal. I would like to thank the court and you, Your Honor, for the time you have allowed me to speak. I would like to thank the prosecutor's office and staff and all the police officers who helped in this case. In closing, I understand the recommendation of the sentence, but I would like to recommend, as a victim myself and the mother of all four murdered children, life in prison without the chance of parole. Thank you. Stay green.
Thank you. I just, you guys, how do you come back from something like that? As a mother myself, like, I could not imagine losing a child, okay, at all. That's it, period. Nothing else needs to be said, okay? Much less losing them in front of you, okay? Much less seeing all the warning signs. Now, I'm not judging this woman in this way, like she's been through enough, but like just hypothetically speaking of anyone, like you can't get any more red flags than this. He's done this before. And I understand the church, the faith, and forgiving and all of that, but you still got to use wisdom, dude. Like, she went down and filed for a divorce in 2013, and for whatever reason, she did not leave him. I can't imagine the guilt she's feeling still to this day. Can you, like, how do you go on after that? How do you even, like, I it's just no words. And then again, like I said, the guilt from the pastor. Like, I mean, no, it's not their fault. It's not their fault that he did this. But I put myself in their shoes and I go, whoa. Now let's get on to Gregory, who really doesn't even deserve to be talked about at all. But I'm sure some of you guys are curious. When he got up there and gave his speech, he started talking about how God had a plan for him. And all. Yes, God does have a plan for you, Gregory, in that prison. If you want to do God's work, you can do it from inside of there. Maybe try to help somebody never go down the path that you went down. Like, the nerve to get up there and act like, you know, like, oh my gosh, you guys, it was brutal to watch. Like, he seriously has to be mentally ill or possessed, because I believe that. I do believe that. Now I'm not on the Lori, you know, daybed. I don't think people are walking around zombies, but I do think there's a spiritual world. And I think some people, baby, it don't make no sense. You guys, Gregory was eventually sentenced to 45 to 100 years. The judge said that if it's, you know, he can't appeal the case. I don't know how he's going to appeal it, but you never know. And let me go and get to, we're going to get to that too. But as of now, he's not up for parole until he's in his 90s. But, like, I don't understand. There's a lot of things that I don't understand about this case. I'm assuming that he did not get the death penalty because he did not take it to trial. I'm assuming that he did not just get life without the How did he even get 45 to 100 years? It should have been life without the possibility of parole. This is the sick. He's killed six people now. And, So, have y'all heard of this? Why is this not all over the place? Okay, why is this not as big as the Chris Watts case? I don't understand. This is a huge wake-up call to a lot of us, I feel like. And I'm going to speak to the ladies because I'm a woman, okay? It ain't nothing against the men and the women out there and whatever. Okay, I'm going to speak to the ladies. I know people. I've been there myself. You guys, some of you guys right now have all the warning signs of a abusive domestic violence type of case. You know, you have them and you're ignoring them for whatever reason. Maybe it's because you're lonely. Maybe it's because you're insecure. Maybe it's because you don't want to be without your baby father or whoever it is, or you don't want to be alone again, or you feel like you can't pay your bills on your own, or whatever it is. Y'all better stop. Pay attention to those signs. Those signs are there for a reason. And a lot of the times we just ignore them. Some of y'all need to listen up and pay attention, okay? You think that if this woman thought he was going to do this, she wouldn't have left. For whatever reason, she thought he wasn't going to do it. You think Shanann Watts, if she thought for a second that her man would do this, she would have stayed, okay? We all think, no, not our man. He wouldn't do that to me. No, he wouldn't. But the signs are there. Y'all better wake up. Pay attention. Protect yourself. Protect your babies. And stop moving your kids in with just the new flavor of the week. That's a whole video we ain't going to get into. But like, this is like, you guys, this is just one of those cases where it's like, how many more red flags could you have had? You know, and like I said, I'm not trying to beat up the mother here or victim shame her, because she's been through enough, like, oh my gosh. But I want this to be a lesson to people watching. Like, you know, you learn from other people's mistakes. This is wild. With all that being said, before I close this video, I want to say that I'm going to be talking to you guys about somebody very soon that y'all already know. You already know their name, that is trying to get out of prison and also saying God has a plan for their life. Say the name downstairs. Say the name in the comment section if you know who I'm talking about. And I wanted to put this video out first because I wanted you guys to, I want this to be fresh. So if you're not already subscribed, make sure you subscribe. Turn on the notification bell so you can hear this. You're not going to want to miss this video. Some of y'all are going to lose your mind when you find out who's trying to get out of prison. Okay? As always, my loves, thank you guys so, so much for watching this video. Don't forget to let me know what you guys think down below. Have you heard of this? Is it wild? What would you have done? I want to know. I'll be reading comments and responding. As always, please do not forget to like this video. It's a free way that you can help your girl out. And until next time, I love you guys so, so, so very much. And I'll see y'all in the next video. Bye. Love you guys. Bye. So